الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وأسلم على من بعث رحمة للعالمين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين وبعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. So we continue with the tafsir of Surah Al-Baqarah. We covered verse number one, some of verse number two last week. We'll try and finish off one or two points of verse number two, which is ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. And then we'll move on to verse numbers 3, 4, and if we can, 5, inshallah, today. There are many virtues of Surah Al-Baqarah that we mentioned one or two of them last week. I'll try and mention every week, not every week, but a couple of weeks, I'll try and mention one or two virtues in the beginning. So one of the other virtues of Surah Al-Baqarah is that Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that inna li kulli shay'in sanaman wa inna sanama al-Qur'ani al-Baqarah, that everything, every single thing has a peak or an apex or a high point. So the apex of the Qur'an, the peak of the Qur'an, is Surah Al-Baqarah. And also Bukhari recorded that one of the Sahabi, Usaid bin Hudayr, said that he was once reciting Surah Al-Baqarah while his horse was tied next to him. The horse started to make some noise while he's reciting Surah Al-Baqarah. When he stopped reciting, the horse stopped. So every time he'd recite, the horse would be moving or feel agitated. The horse would feel agitated. Then he started reciting, the horse started moving again, meaning it's tied up and it's uncomfortable, or something's happening to the horse every time he recites Surah Al-Baqarah or recites the Quran. He was reciting Surah Al-Baqarah. Meanwhile, he also had his son next to him. So because he feared the horse may trample his son, he stopped reciting. When he moved his son back and looked up, he saw a cloud. And the cloud was shining, radiating with light that looked like lamps. So he looked up into the sky. After he moved his son, he saw a cloud full of lamps, like lights in the cloud, and it was shining. It was radiating light. In the morning, he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he told him what had happened. And he said, O Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, my son Yahya was so close to the horse and I feared that the horse might step on him. When I attended to him and raised my head to the sky, I saw a cloud with lights like lamps. So I went, but I couldn't see it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, do you know what that was? He said, no. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, تلك الملائكة دنت لصوتك ولو قرأت لأصبحت ينظر لأصبحت ينظر الناس إليها لا تتوارى منهم. Do you know what that was? He said, no. The Prophet ﷺ said that those were angels who came down to listen to your voice reciting Surah Al-Baqarah, reciting the Quran. And he said, if you continued reciting, then the people would have woken up in the morning. So this must have been at night or something. If you continued reciting, the people would have come out and actually see the angels. They would be able to see the angels, because this is how much attention they were paying to his recitation of Surah Al-Baqarah. One of the questions one of the brothers asked when we said in this verse, verse number 2, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, when I said there is no doubt in this book, that is the book, or this is the book in which there is no doubt, no suspicion. And it also means رَيْب is also tuhma. It's also something when you accuse or suspect or when you blame something. There's no blameworthy traits of this book. There is nothing suspicious or doubtful in this book. And I use the word truth. It's full of truth. It's haq. So one of the brothers asked, should we be using that kind of language as fact and truth? Should we use something else perhaps in this day and age? One of the things we as Muslims really need to understand is the society we're living in the West. We've reached a position when it comes to philosophy, when it comes to understanding the nature of the world, when it comes to understanding worldviews. Postmodernism says that there is no truth with a capital T. There is no truth with a capital T. Everything is simply truth for you. It's relative to you. There's truth with a small t. Meaning, whatever worldview you have, whatever belief you have, that's fine for you. It doesn't mean it's true. There are no truths. This is the state we've reached in the West in terms of philosophy. But the Quran is completely opposite to that. And we as Muslims, we must have that confidence. We must have that confidence of the Quran. The confidence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's words is giving us. That this is haq, this is the truth, there is no doubt in it. The Quran has challenged mankind for 14 centuries to bring a surah like it, to bring an ayah like it. Its construction, the sentences, the meanings, the powerful imagery that the Quran evokes, these are all part of the miracle of the Quran. The scientific facts, although we don't depend on that alone, but there are some basic scientific facts mentioned in the Quran which could not have been known at the time. But beyond that, that's not the most important part of the Quran. The Quran, most important part is the guidance, is that it doesn't contradict each other, is its beauty, its eloquence, its power to move people, to change people, to change the world. That is the miracle of the Quran. And the beginning of the book, or the longest chapter of the book, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. There is no doubt in it at all. It is the truth. And Muslims have to be certain, Muslims have to be confident. But the only way we're going to be confident and certain and have that confidence, yaqeen, in the book is if we study it, is if we understand it, is if we understand the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If we read about our deen, if you read about the deen, if you study the deen, the Islamic sciences, at least on a basic level, if you study the Quran, you will come to the conclusion that this is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the truth. And Muslims must be confident. It doesn't mean we become arrogant. It doesn't mean we deny every other way of life. People have the freedom they choose. That's fine. You have your freedom. You have your opinion. You don't agree with us. Fine. That's not a problem. But we mustn't lose our confidence and our faith simply because somebody or a paradigm out there is criticizing religion or is criticizing the possibility of there being a religious book from the heavens or the word of God or revelation. Our faith should not be shaken. Many Muslims' faith is shaken and has been shaken simply because of the criticisms of certain people. But we as Muslims, we should have that yaqeen, like Abu Bakr radiallahu an, who when he was told, when the Quraysh were mocking about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said that he had been to Jerusalem, Masjid al-Aqsa, in the night of Isra and Mi'raj, and he'd been to the seven heavens and back, and they were mocking him. How could you go to Masjid al-Aqsa in the night and come back in the night? They were mocking him. They thought this is the best weapon we have against Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But when they come to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, what did he say? He said, if he said it, then I believe it. If he said it, I believe it. Straight away. They had no transport that time. They had no airplanes. They had no means of getting somewhere in a few hours in the night. They knew, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he knew that was a several months journey there and back. But look at the yaqeen, look at the faith. If he said it, if the Prophet ﷺ said it, I believe it. It's truth. There's no wavering. This is how we must be with the Quran, and this is how we will be with the Quran if we study it properly. Then one or two points about Hudal lil Muttaqin to finish off, because we discussed last week many points on Hidayah and Muttaqin. One of the things to notice here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says Hudal lil Muttaqin, meaning the guidance is for those people of taqwa. There's an indication there that beneficial knowledge, which is guidance, beneficial knowledge cannot come to a heart that doesn't have taqwa. Meaning the heart has to be purified, the heart has to be clean, the heart has to be full of taqwa, or at least have a baseline of taqwa. It must be a fearful heart, a heart that is conscious, a heart that has love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning, you need a sound heart to receive the guidance. So the prerequisite of receiving the guidance is to have a sound heart, is to have a clean heart, or at least a heart that is willing to accept the truth, to go through a process of purification. So that's why Huda lil Muttaqin, the connection here between Huda, guidance, and Muttaqin, those who have taqwa. And this is very important. The heart, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, taqwa is here three times. And he touched his chest, his heart, meaning pointing to the heart. Taqwa is here. So this is the beginning of taqwa. It's in the heart. And the Prophet ﷺ said, there is a piece of flesh in the body. If it is sound, the whole body is sound. If it is corrupted, the whole body is corrupted. Isn't this the heart? Isn't that the heart? So without a sound heart, we cannot expect to be guided or to receive beneficial knowledge. It's like the rain. The rain falls on many different types of land. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives that parable in the Quran. It's the same rain that falls on the rock, on the mountains, on the grass, on the fields, in the sea. It's the same rain. But according to the place it falls on, there's a different effect. Only that earth and soil that is good can benefit from the rain in terms of it grows crops or plants or whatever. Only that soil that is ready and that is good and that has been prepared, that soil will benefit from the rain. That's like the heart. The guidance can be coming, but if it's not ready, if it's not prepared, if it's not sound, it will not be guided. So this is one of the lessons to learn from this sentence structure of Hudal lil Muttaqin. It is a guidance for those people who have taqwa, meaning whose hearts have taqwa, people of taqwa who purify their hearts. Another aspect of the Quran being Huda, guidance. And also in the Arabic language, when you have a word that is indefinite, meaning, say in English, if you say a house, this is indefinite. A house, it could be any house. It's indefinite. If you say the house, this is definite. You add the, that's the definite article. You make it definite, the house. It's a specific house. Here in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Hudan, indefinite, with the tanween. Hudan lil muttaqin. Why is this indefinite? One of the meanings of this is when you make a word indefinite in the Quran, not in the Quran, sorry, in the Arabic language, one of the meanings is that it means abundance of. It means it's an abundance of guidance. It's not just a small amount of guidance. It's a huge amount of guidance. The other connection with Quran being a guidance is that the guidance, Huda, or the Quran, is not just the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that's it. It's not just words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we see written in the Mus'haf or that we hear or that we recite. No, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it gives out its own light. It has a light. it has a spirit, it has a ruh. These words, they have an effect. It has nur and ruh. And this is what mixes with the heart. This light from the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This spirit, this ruh from the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what mixes in the heart. And this is what illuminates the heart. It gives it a light by which we can see, by which we are guided, by which we can differentiate between haqq and batil, between right and wrong, between sin and reward. This is the guidance through which we can see the akhirah before the dunya. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أَوَمَنْ كَانَ مَيْتًا فَأَحْيَيْنَاهُ وَجَعَلْنَا لَهُ نُورًا يَمْشِي بِهِ فِي النَّاسِ كَمَنْ مَثَلُهُ فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ لَيْسَ بِخَارِجٍ مِّنْهَا. Is he the same, the one whom we brought back to life, or gave him a life, and we made for him a light by which he walks amongst the people? And they said it means the one who walks ahead of the people with the light. Everyone else is in darkness, but this person, he walks ahead and people are following him. Why? Because he has a light. He can show the path to the others whilst everything else is in darkness. Is he the same as the one who is in dhulumat, is in pure darkness, and he can't come out of that darkness? Are they the same? Of course not. This is the Quran. It is a light. The words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is a light there, there is a nur there, and this is what mixes in the heart. This is what impacts the heart, and this is what causes us to see through the light of the Quran. And this is what causes us to be guided. And this point is very important for us as a community. Especially in the West now, especially, well, it doesn't have to be even in the West. Some of our community situation in the East or in the Middle East is even worse. Whenever we are under attack, whenever we are being oppressed, whenever we are in a crisis, whenever we see the future is bleak, people are gathered around us to attack us. Doesn't have to be physically, to dishonor us, to twist our reputations, to accuse us of things we haven't done. Whenever we are in this situation, what's the first thing that people do is they look for a way out. But when they look for a way out, we look to leaders, religious leaders, community leaders, shuyukh, whatever, for a way out and a solution. You will hear many voices, as we do today, of what is the solution for Muslims in the West? What is the solution for Muslims in America? What is the solution for Muslims in Europe or Britain? You'll hear many, many different responses. But you know, if you read this ayah, that only the person who has the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the light of the Quran, he is or she is the only one who can guide others when it comes to a solution. You will hear different responses, some very predictable, some pie in the sky solutions, some completely against the teachings of Islam, some just immature responses, some just full of emotion and anger. You will hear many responses. Do this, do that, go this way. We must do that. The only people who can guide you are those who have internalized the Quran. Those who have got the light, the nur of the Quran in their heart. Their hearts are illuminated. Their path ahead is illuminated. They can be leaders and people can follow them because they are on basira. They are on an inner sight. They are on, like the verse said, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made for him a light by which he is guided and guides others. So beware of solutions that come from many different quarters, but they're not based on or they're not informed or motivated, or they do not arise as a result of this light of the Quran. Our solutions are here in the Quran. And then the last thing about this ayah, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. that you enter as soon as you believe in this book, and that there is no doubt in this book, you enter into guidance. But this guidance is on a general level. The guidance that you've entered into, as soon as you believe in this book, that there's no doubt in this book is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the Quran. I believe in it. As soon as you believe in it, you enter into a realm, a space of guidance. But this is a general guidance. You can say level one of guidance. You've entered into the space of guidance, like introductory level, beginner's level, level one. Then every time you increase in taqwa, every time you increase in taqwa, because the guidance, the huda, is related to the taqwa. Every time you increase in taqwa, you go up another level in guidance, in hidayah. And like this, it goes on. There's no end. There are no ends to the levels of hidayah, to the levels of guidance. There is no end. Every time, no matter how pious you are, no matter what your situation is, how good your salah and fasting, no matter how pious you are, there's always a guidance level above you. And the more taqwa you have, the more you will be guided. You will move up to another level of guidance. And the opposite is true, the vice versa is true. When we fail, when we have shortcomings in taqwa meaning here, obeying the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, having that love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, having that reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and staying away from his prohibitions, staying away from his sins, staying away from everything that angers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislikes, the more we lose in taqwa, the more we lose in guidance. Our level comes down. It's very, very closely connected. You increase in taqwa, you increase in hidayah. You decrease in taqwa, you decrease in hidayah. You will not have that level of guidance. And what do we mean by this guidance, this hidayah? As I said last week, that this guidance is on many fronts. It will allow you to see truth and batil, truth and falsehood, and differentiate. It will allow you to make the correct decisions. It will allow you to implement the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It will allow you to do those things that please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It will allow you to purify your heart. It will allow you to make those daily decisions of your life which will be beneficial for your dunya and akhirah, as opposed to becoming weak, falling into the traps of shaitan along the road, as opposed to committing sins, as opposed to creating doubts in your heart, as opposed to reducing in your ibadat, as opposed to making the wrong choices or being lured by the dunya or by wealth or by fame or something else. Because every day of our lives we make these decisions, whether to follow the guidance or whether to go against the guidance. In every situation we're making these decisions constantly, consciously or unconsciously. So this guidance that we're talking about, if we increase in taqwa, we will increase in this capacity to act in accordance to guidance, to act in a way that is illuminated by the guidance of the Quran. This is the hidayah, the huda that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about here. So there are no end to the levels. So believers should always be striving that I haven't reached any sort of level, I must reach the next level. And this is where the competition between the believers should be in doing good deeds, in competing in charity, in good acts of worship, in helping others, in servicing to your relatives and families. This is where the believers should be competing in, not just the dunya, but the akhirah, in the realm of guidance, in the realm of hidayah. So this is something we must remember. And the taqwa is also not just fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Taqwa literally means to avoid that thing that harms you. It's not just fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is this scary being, that He is always angry and He always punishes. No. Taqwa is to fear the consequences of your own actions. I fear my action because it's a sin. It will lead to misery and loss and harm in this dunya and in the akhirah. That is what I should fear, the consequences of my sin. So the fear gets focused into something that will harm me. Something that will harm me. That is taqwa. That I avoid that harm. I protect myself. How do I protect myself? I run to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I run to His pleasure. I run to obey His commands. I run to implement whatever He said. I run to follow the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is how, through love and obedience, that I will protect myself from my own deeds. So this is the taqwa we're talking about, that if you can increase in that, you will increase in your hidayah, in your level of guidance. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the next three ayahs, so after saying, هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now explains or further elaborates on who are the muttaqeen. What are their characteristics? So in verse 3, from verse 3, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَىٰ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. So He says three things here. And then the next verse, وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ. Those who believe in that which has been revealed to you and that which was revealed before you, and with the akhirah, about the akhirah, the next world, they have certainty, they have yaqeen. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, those who believe in the unseen, these are the characteristics of who? The muttaqeen. Those who believe in the unseen. Those who establish prayer. Those who spend out of that which we have provided them. Number four, those who believe in the book that has been revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the book before, and all of the books before Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's four and five. And six, those who have full yaqeen, full iman, and yaqeen in the hereafter. Yaqeen is the word used here, not iman. So this is the characteristic of the muttaqeen. Me and you should question ourselves, do I fit in the characteristics that has been described here? These are the people of taqwa. These are the people who this Quran will be a guidance for. How much have I earned the description of the muttaqeen? Just question yourself, question myself. Because this is, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends off this section by saying, أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَىٰ هُدًى مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. These are the people who are on a guidance from their Lord. And these are the ones who are muflihun. These are the successful ones. So the beginning of these few ayahs begins with هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ or ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابِ, the book and guidance, and it ends with telling you that these are the people of guidance and these are the people of success. So we must question ourselves properly and go through each of these verses and see, number one, أَلَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ, those who believe in the unseen. غَيْب is literally anything that you cannot see. Unseen here, the scholar said everything in believing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, believe in the angels, believe in the day of judgment, in the books that were before, etc., etc. These are the things that we have full iman in, that we believe in. Iman is simply to believe somebody, or to have belief in, to have faith, to have trust in what somebody is saying. Linguistically, simply, it can also mean to trust or believe somebody who's saying something to you. That's iman. You have iman in his saying. So you just attest to the truth of what he's saying. But the Akhirah we have not seen. The ghaib, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have not seen. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked by some of his companions that we have believed in you, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have defended you, we have sacrificed our wealth, we have fought on your side, we have sacrificed. Are there any believers that come after us that will be on the same level as us? Will they have the same rank as us? The Prophet ﷺ said, you saw me, you see me, I'm in front of you, and you have believed. But those who come after you without seeing me, they have my apologies, this is not from the Prophet ﷺ, it's from a Sahaba who was asked by other Sahabas. He said that those that come after you, they have not seen the Prophet ﷺ. They will simply believe by hearing or reading about the Prophet ﷺ. They will believe in the ghaib. For them, the Prophet ﷺ is in the ghaib. They can't see him. They haven't seen him. But they will believe. He said, they are much better than you in their belief, in their iman. Of course, we all know the Sahaba, they are the best in the Ummah. But just reflect on that for a moment. It's a big blessing for us to have iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, without a doubt. But it's just reflect on how big this ni'mah is. The Sahaba is saying, those people are better than you because you lived in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you saw him. Of course you're going to believe him. What about those who come afterwards? That is a test of faith. That is a test of belief in al-ghayb. So these people of taqwa, muttaqeen, they are the ones who believe in the unseen. That is the core of iman. That is the core of faith. Then, وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. They establish prayer. Before we go on to prayer, sorry. Iman, very quickly, iman comes in different shapes and forms in the Quran. Sometimes iman comes on its own. When it comes on its own, they said iman includes faith and actions, both. Iman includes faith. If you see iman without any condition, without any another description to it, or joined with another word like amilus salihat, right? Righteous deeds. These are not joined with the word iman. It comes on its own. Here it means iman, faith and deeds, practice and speech, includes everything. So iman is not just in the heart. Many Muslims have this misconception. I don't pray, I don't fast. Alhamdulillah, I'm Muslim. You know, does it? Iman is, as long as I love Allah, as long as I believe in Allah, that's what's important. You'll hear this very common amongst people who either don't want to practice or haven't had the chance to study the deen and understand what is iman or Islam. People often react with this. As long as it's in my heart, that's where iman and religion and faith is. No, iman by definition has to be on the limbs. By definition, it's deeds, it's amal. It's iman and amal is included, and speech as well. So this is the first thing. But when it comes with amal, faith and deeds are mentioned together in the Quran, then iman means just the faith. And amal means the practice. But when it comes on its own, iman means that faith and practice. So those who believe in the ghaib, it's not just a stationary, stagnant belief. That I believe in Allah, I believe in the books, I believe in the Day of Judgment, I believe in the angels, and that's it. I don't do anything about it. No, iman means it has to move you to do something about it. Iman means it has to be dynamic. It has to move you to act on it, because that is the definition of iman. Faith and action. There must be action with it. And this is, look at the beautiful way the sentence is constructed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. And then straight away, وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. It's as though the natural next step after iman is what? Establishing prayer and spending from charity. It's natural. It's the next step. It must be present. You can't separate it. Iman and Salah, you cannot separate it. The Prophet ﷺ said, between kufr and iman is as-salah. Between kufr and iman, the difference between rejecting faith, rejecting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, rejecting the book, and having faith, iman, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the book and the messengers, is as-salah. They never considered, the Sahabas never considered anybody who deliberately misses prayers. They wouldn't consider them as part of the community of believers. Impossible. Even the munafiqun had to pray 5 times a day in the masjid. Even the hypocrites had to come for salah in the masjid 5 times a day. It's impossible. Sahabas would imagine that a believer, a Muslim, doesn't pray. It's impossible. They wouldn't imagine that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those who establish the prayer, so the iman is faith and action. And then establishing the prayer, we return back to the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. One of the duas which I mentioned, I didn't give a reference last week, is in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 129, where Ibrahim alayhi salam, this is generic, but this is the dua he makes about sending a messenger amongst his descendants. رَبَّنَا وَبْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ وَيُعَلِّمْهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. That, O my Lord, O our Lord, send amongst them a messenger from themselves who will recite to them your verses and teach them the book and wisdom and purify them. Indeed, you are the exalted in might, the wise. And remember, I said that the Surah Al-Baqarah, the whole of the Surah, all of its aspects is related to this fulfillment of this dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. The coming of the new messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, the changing of the Qibla, and the new Ummah. And one of the key things, in another place, Ibrahim alayhi salam says that make my children those who establish prayer. Those who establish prayer. Establishing prayer means to do the salah properly, with its ruku', with its sujood, with its standing, recitation. To do all the parts of the salah individually, properly, first of all. Then to do all the preparation before it properly, the wudu, or if you need a ghusl or whatever, your clothing, your space where you're praying. It is to perfect the salah, is to establish and do it properly and consistently. And everywhere you see salah, it's always, nearly always, whatever is said over 70 times in the Quran, it's always come as establish the salah. A few times maybe those who pray and things like that come. But mostly, the vast majority of time is establish the salah, meaning it is something permanent in the lives of the believers. It's something established. It's like a pillar you put up in your house. You don't take it down every second and destroy it, or it's not there sometimes and it's there some. No. Salah is a pillar which must be a permanent feature of a believer's life. And salah, there is nothing better than the fard prayers on the face of this earth. Nothing better. And salah, for those who don't pray, they neglect it. Those who do pray, after a while, we belittle salah. We think in Islam there are other things, and we think those things are more important than the salah. We think salah, we're doing salah, alhamdulillah, we're praying 5 times a day, and we don't think much of it. We move on, if you like. But actually, you come back, the Quran and its emphasis on salah and charity, zakat, salah and zakat, or salah and infaq, fi sabilillah, is unparalleled. No other worship is mentioned as much times as salah and zakah, or salah and spending fi sabilillah. There's no other worship mentioned the same. So there's no other worship on the face of this earth that is greater in reward and benefit than the fard prayers. It is our daily, it is the first pillar of worship, and the only one to be revealed in the heavens on the night of Isra and Mi'raj. It was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, the five daily prayers. The obligation of the prayers was revealed where? In the heavens, not on the earth, and we all know this. It is the daily, it is the believer's daily ascension to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is your individual mi'raj to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whereby as soon as you say Allahu Akbar, you come in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hassan al-Basri, when he was making wudu, his face was pale. It was almost like he was fearing something, full of anxiety. And they said, what's the matter? He said, do you not know in front of whom I am about to go and stand? So as soon as you say the takbir, you are standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are transported, you are transformed to the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as soon as you say takbir. And then, as we mentioned in Surah Al-Fatiha, you are in conversation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The salah has the nourishment, all of the types of nourishment that the heart needs. The salah has all of the types of nourishment. The food, the sustenance of the heart is contained in the salah. If only we do it properly with full conscious and meaning and understanding, from the ruku' to the takbir, to the tasbih, to the recitation of the Quran, to the dhikr, to the istighfar, to the sitting. All of these different aspects have a powerful effect on the heart. It's like the banquet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But many of us, we say we come to this banquet every day, we're still starving. We don't seem to have been nourished by the food in the banquet. Why? Because we're not doing it properly. We're nibbling at the edges. We're not eating. We're not taking the food and eating it. We're not consuming the food of the banquet which is present in the salah. We are simply coming at the edge, taking one grain of rice, eating it and saying we're still hungry. So the salah, it is the beginning of the believer's journey and it is the end of the believer's journey. It is that worship which we must do regardless of our condition, regardless of our physical condition. Almost very few things will give you a license not to pray. Even then, if you become better, you must make it up. Even in the battlefield, people must pray. Even in the battlefield, people must pray. Even at the time of war, people must pray. This is the importance of the salah. It is the first thing that we will be questioned about on the Day of Judgment. All the ibadat will follow what will follow salah. If you pass the salah test, you'll pass the others inshaAllah. As Umar radiallahu anhu, he said that whoever has protected and guarded his prayers has protected his deen. Whoever has wasted or has been careless about his salah, he has been careless and wasted his deen. So as believers, and especially in these times and conditions where people are offering so many solutions, and if you say to them the solution partly and in a great way lies in the salah, a lot of people will say, oh, this brother's a Sufi, or maybe he's a tablighi, just do prayers and the world will change. Just do prayers and nothing else and Allah's going to help you. Ridiculous. But the Quran is telling us it is the salah that will change everything. It doesn't mean just pray and do nothing else, obviously. Whatever you're facing in terms of problems and challenges, you must be proactive and use your wisdom and use your resources and intelligence to defend yourself or to take proactive action, to have a strategy. That goes without saying. But if you're doing that without the pillar of salah being established either in yourself or your community, you will not achieve results. Allah's success will not come. إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُ الصَّلَاةِ. If we establish them on the earth, they establish the prayer. This is the first thing. The people who are established or given authority on the land, the first description of them, أَقَامُ الصَّلَاةِ. They establish salah. وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Seek the help and aid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with sabr and salah. When Musa alayhi salam was oppressed and his people were oppressed and enslaved, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Musa alayhi salam to tell his people, make their buyut qibla, meaning make musalla in their houses. Before you are released from your oppressors, before you achieve your freedom from your enslavement, before you are rescued by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the precondition is as-salah, the prayer. Look at the condition of our community. How many Muslims actually pray 5 times a day, the fard salah? How can we expect huge miracles and changes? إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. That indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He does not change the condition of a people until they change what is with amongst themselves, with whatever condition they are in, until they change their own condition. So without the salah, we cannot expect not just me praying and a few people here praying. We as an ummah, we as a community, we as a neighborhood, we must be in salah. We must be establishing prayer. This is the first criteria. This is the first description of the muttaqeen. This is the first precondition of receiving hidayah, of guidance. And without this light, without this guidance, we cannot change our condition. We cannot come out of the crisis that we find ourselves in. And also, there, throughout these verses, there is a rebuke, an ishara, and a rebuke and criticism of the people that went before the Muslims, the people of the book, the ones who had revelation before. Every single verse in these verses, Surah Baqarah, is referring to one of the nations of the people of the book. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. This is the book in which there is no doubt. But the people of the book, the two other nations, they started doubting in their book because of the changes that were made. هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. And then guidance for the muttaqeen became problematic because they started doubting and changing and not following their book. And here, that those who believe in the unseen have full firm faith. These are the believers, the Muslims. That their description is that they have that and they establish prayer. And in a way, the Quran is indicated that the previous nations, they lost their prayers. They lost the prayers that they were ordered and commanded to establish. They lost their prayers. Then Allah subhanahu, so this is a very important point. To establish salah is not simply a few of us pray, not simply we pray absent-minded. We could go on and on about salah. There's so many things to say, but I'd recommend people to read good books on salah, read the tafsir of these ayahs to improve our salah. I'm not sure in English, but there's a few books in Arabic. Some of them may have been translated. Look out for them. It will really improve our salah, inshallah. But we as a community, we must return to salah if we're to change our condition. It won't happen without that. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they spend وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ, that they spend from that which we have provided, that which we have provided for them. The first thing is وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ. Immediately Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, and from what we have provided, they spend. Meaning, number one is a reminder, the wealth you spend, whether it's in zakah or voluntary charity, it's not your wealth. It's coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the favor and blessing. He's the one who's giving you the wealth to allow you to earn rewards by spending it. And the second thing is that you simply have to give some of your wealth. وَمِمَّا مِنْ here, تَبْعِيد, for just a portion, a part of your wealth, not all of your wealth. Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through His infinite mercy, has made it easy to spend wealth. Why? Because you just have to spend a portion of it, whether it's zakah or voluntary charity. You just have to spend a portion of it. The Prophet ﷺ said, save yourselves from the hellfire, even if it is with half a date. SubhanAllah, half a date. Save yourselves from the hellfire, even if it is half a date. And the people of the hellfire will say before they're thrown in, oh Allah, give us another chance. Give us another chance. We will do righteous deeds. And in another part, we will spend. So spend before you have no time to spend. Spend from our wealth, even a small portion on a regular basis. This should be. And the Sahabas, that's how they earn paradise. We heard in the khutbah today how Uthman radiallahu an, by paying 35,000 dirhams for a spring and gifting it fi sabilillah to the Muslim community because they were in hardship and they didn't have abundant access to water, how he earned paradise. The Prophet gave him good news, you've earned paradise through this one act. And there's many other acts like that from the Sahaba who spent one single transaction and they bought paradise just from spending. And Aisha radiallahu anha, she used to put perfume on the money before she gave it in charity. Because she said it goes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts it first before it goes to the hand of the recipient. This is the yaqeen they had, the faith they had, the love and the adab they had. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst them.